वनचारी यमुना तीरा वनचारी जय राधा माधव कुंज बिहारी जय राधा माधव कुंज बिहारी गोपी जन वल्लभ गिरिवर धारी जय गोपी जन वल्लभ गिरिवर धारी यशोदानंदन ब्रज जन रंजन यशोदानंदन ब्रज जन रंजन यमुना तीरावनचारी यमुना तीरावनचारी जय राधा माधव कुंज बिहारी जय राधा माधव कुंज बिहारी
जय ओं विष्णुपाद परमहंस परिव्राजकाचार्य अष्टोत्तरित श्री श्रीमद् डिवाइन ग्रेस एसी भक्तिवेदांत स्वामी श्रील प्रभुपाद की अनंत कोटि वैष्णव वृंद की ग्रंथराज श्रीमद् भागवतम की निताय गौर प्रेमानंदे ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय नारायणं नमस्कृत्य नरं चैव नरोत्तमं देवीं सरस्वतीं व्यासं ततो जयमुदीरयेत् नष्टप्रायेषु भद्रेषु नित्यं भागवतसेवया भगवती उत्तमश्लोके भक्तिर्भवति नैष्ठिकी हरे कृष्ण सो वी आर रीडिंग फ्रॉम श्रीमद् भागवतम कैंटो 11 चैप्टर 21 टाइटल्ड ज्ञान योग वर्स नंबर 22 अविद्यमानोऽप्यवभासते यो वैकारिको राजस सर्ग एषः ब्रह्मस्वयं ज्योतिरतो विभाति ब्रह्मेन्द्रियार्थात्मविकारचित्रम् अविद्यमानोऽप्यवभासते यो वैकारिको राजस सर्ग एषः ब्रह्मस्वयं ज्योतिरतो विभाति ब्रह्मेन्द्रियार्थात्मविकारचित्रम् अविद्यमानोऽप्यवभासते यो वैकारिको राजससर्ग एषः ब्रह्म स्वयं ज्योतिरतो विभाति ब्रह्मेन्द्रियार्थात्मविकारचित्रम् अविद्यमानोऽप्यवभासते यो वैकारिको राजससर्ग एषः ब्रह्म स्वयं ज्योतिरतो विभाति ब्रह्मेन्द्रियार्थात्मविकारचित्रम् अविद्यमानोऽप्यवभास ब्रह्म स्वयं ज्योतिरतो ब्रह्मेन्द्रियार्थात्मविकार वैकारिको राजससर्ग एषः ब्रह्म स्वयं ज्योतिरतो विभाति ब्रह्मेन्द्रियार्थात्मविकारचित्रम् अविद्यमानः actually not existing api although avabhasate appears yaha which vaikarikah manifestation of transformations rajasa of the mode of passion sargah the creation eshah this brahma The absolute truth, on the other hand, swayam established in himself, jyotihi, luminous, ataha, therefore, vibhati, becomes manifest, brahma, the absolute truth, indriya, of the senses, artha, their objects, Atma, the mind, Vikara, and of the transformations of the five gross elements. Chitram, as the variety. Translation purport by disciples of Srila Prabhupada. Although thus not existing in reality, this manifestation of transformations created from the mode of passion appears real. Because the self-manifested, self-luminous, absolute truth exhibits himself in the form of the material variety of the senses, the sense objects, the mind, and the elements of physical nature. Purport. The total material nature, Pradhan, is originally undifferentiated and inert. But later, it undergoes transformation when the Supreme Lord, through his time agent, glances upon it and activates the mode of passion. Material transformation thus takes place and is exhibited as the Lord's inferior energy. In contrast, the Supreme Lord's personal abode possesses eternal variety, which is the self-luminous internal opulence of the Absolute Truth and is not subject to material creation, transformation or annihilation. The material world is in this way simultaneously one with and different from the absolute truth. Om Ajnanatimirandasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Chakshurun Militam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha Shri Chaitanya Manobhishtam Sthapitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupa Kadamahyam Dadati Swapadantikam Vandeham Shri Guru Shri Yuta Padakamalam Shri Gurun Vaishnavamscha श्री रूपं सागर जातां सहगणा रघुनाथान्वितं तां सजीवं साद्वैतं सावधूतं परिजना सहितं कृष्ण चैतन्यदेवं श्री राधा कृष्णपादान् सहगणा ललिता श्री विशाखान्वितांश्च हे कृष्ण करुणा सिंधो दीनबंधो जगत्पते गोपेश गोपिका कांत राधा कांता नमोस्तुते तप्त कांचन गौरांगी राधे वृंदावनेश्वरी वृषभानुसुते देवी प्रणमामि हरिप्रिये वांछाकल्पतरुभ्यश्च कृपा सिंधुभ्य एव च पतितानां पावनेभ्यो वैष्णवेभ्यो नमो नमः श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर श्रीवासादि गौरभक्तवृंद हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे 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 रामा 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 हरे हरे। हरे कृष्णा। So before I begin, I would like to seek the blessings of all the assembled devotees here. So as we see in this section of the Srimad Bhagavatam, 11th canto, Krishna is teaching Uddhava about the varieties of illusion created, how the living entity gets trapped in this variety of material illusion. And in contrast, how the spiritual world exhibits real variety towards which we should get attracted and aspire for. So, this nature of this illusory variety we find in the Bhagavad Gita, chapter 15, famous verses about the inverted banyan tree. So the spiritual world is there, which is the reality, and it is reflected as the material world. So just like a banyan tree is there standing on the bank of a river, so when we see the reflection, all the elements of the original tree are visible in the reflection. So banyan tree or any tree, we see the reflection will contain everything that is present in the original. So if someone dives into the tree, dives into the river, eager to enjoy the fruits hanging on the tree, then he may dive deep inside, but he won't experience, he won't get access to the fruits. So if it is nice, golden, juicy fruits, mango fruits on the tree, and he sees the reflection, dives into it, searching for the mangoes, he won't get anything. But he says, I have seen them. I actually saw them. Nice juicy fruits, so much variety in the bushes of the leaves. When I am outside, I can see. From a distance, it appears so beautiful and attractive. But when I dive inside, I don't see anything. So therefore, Krishna says, we are looking for the right thing at the wrong place. We are searching for happiness, hankering for happiness, but we don't know where to look for it. The real place is the spiritual world. Natat bhasayate suryo nashashanko napavakaha yad gatvan anivartante tad dhama paramam. Prabhupada writes in that purport, after describing the nature of the spiritual world, he says, one must be captivated by this information, captivated by the attractive features of the spiritual world. Only then we will start aspiring to go there. If you are not captivated by spiritual variety, we automatically get captivated by material variety, the illusory variety. Captivated we must to something, by something. So therefore, the more we hear about the varieties of the spiritual world, the real actual varieties, then gradually our desires awaken to go to that place. Yad gatva nanivartante taddhama paramam mama. So in that section of the discussion on material variety, Krishna says, the real form of the tree cannot be perceived in this world. No one can understand where it ends, where it begins, or where its foundation is. But with determination, one must cut down. Asanga shastrena dridhena chitva. Thereafter, one must seek that place which having gone, one never returns. And those who are free from false prestige, illusion and false association, who are freed from the dualities of happiness and distress, know how to surrender to that Supreme Person, attain to that eternal kingdom. So in this way, the network of illusion, material variety, we get in the search for that illusory happiness, we get entangled and caught up, and we cannot figure out how to get out of that illusion. In another section of the same Gita, Krishna talks about the illusory nature of material sense gratification. And the 15th chapter also, a little later, he talks about how, what is that verse? Yatanto yoginaschainam pasyantyatmanyavasthitam. Yatanto apyakritatmano nainam pasyantyachetasaha. So, those who are caught in material illusion cannot perceive the spiritual realities. So, what we see or what we are able to see depends on what we want to see. Suppose, for example, there is an alcoholic, drunkard. So when he comes to a new city, a new place, there may be so many things in the city. There will be entertainment park, gardens and nice buildings and roads and movie theaters. But this person is focused on only one thing. Where can I find alcohol? All the varieties of alcohol. So if you ask him, do you know where the hospital is or where the schools are, where the offices are? He may, I don't know. But if you ask him, do you know where the liquor shop is? He may give you a list of 10 names where you'll find all the best variety versions of liquor. So what you want to see, that's what you see. Similarly, other thing. If we go into a temple, we may look where the ISKCON temple is, where Prabhupada centers are, devotees are, because that's what we want to see. And we may not know anything else about that location. We may find very good prasad is available. That's probably our focus when we go to a city. So in this way, we get to see, we notice only those things that we want to see. Similarly, so this verse in the 15th chapter, Krishna says, if we are too attached to that material objects of sense gratification, we will never perceive spiritual realities. Yatanto api akritatmano nainam pasyanti achetasaha. So so in this example, as a person cannot see other things, similarly, we people who are engrossed in material things can remain blind to an altogether different level of reality. Not just certain objects, certain places, certain locations, but entire level of reality may remain inaccessible to us if we are too engrossed in material level of reality. So how can we then perceive spiritual reality? So there are three ways. That desire has to be cultivated. If we are eager and hankering for something higher, superior, then we are able to access. So a couple of ways how we can access is, first is through knowledge. When we get the information and knowledge about spiritual world, their dimensions, their the people there and the activities happening there, that knowledge can arouse that desire within us to go for that place, to aspire for that place. Another thing that arouses our desire is the association. With whom we associate. Sangat sanjayate kama. Association kindles the desire within us. In the right association, we get the right desires. In the bad association, we get negative desires. Jaisa sang, vaisa rang, as they say. So if we associate with spiritually minded, like-minded people, then naturally we remain tuned in to that kind of desires, that kind of reality. And we will start aspiring for those things. And also purification. Anarthas, if there are many within our heart, then the anarthas block our vision of spiritual realities. Anarthas are like, if you compare it to the three modes, the mode of ignorance is like the deepest, thickest covering. Yathol benavrato garbhasthathate. How does it begin? Dhume na vriyate vannir yatha darsho malena cha yathol benavrato garbhasthathate nedamavartam. So, a living entity is covered by different layers of ignorance. Krishna compares it with a mirror covered with dust, fire covered with smoke, and an embryo covered by the womb. So, when a fire is covered with smoke, that is like a human life. The covering is least thick. So it's easier to remove the smoke and awaken that spiritual consciousness. Mode of passion means a mirror covered by dust. It's a little more effort has to be put in order to clean the mirror and see the real face of the mirror. And embryo covered by a womb, that's like animal life, mode of ignorance, where you need to put, it's almost impossible to awaken those people to a level of spiritual consciousness. So purification is essential. When the covering is removed, cheto darpan marjanam happens, then we are able to see what is actual reality. Otherwise, after layers and layers of accumulated dust is there, and when we see, look at that mirror with layers of dust, we don't see anything. When it is partially cleaned, some dust is there, we may see a hazy picture of ourselves. But until it is thoroughly cleaned, we cannot see what our original form is, images. We see a distorted, perverted image of ourselves. So therefore, purification of the heart is essential in order to perceive actual realities. Krishna also talks about the illusory nature of sense pleasures. What we think is so pleasurable eventually turns into poison. Yattadagre vishamiva pariname mrtopamam. Happiness in the mode of goodness, happiness in the mode of passion. Vishayendriya sanyogad yattadagre mrtopamam pariname vishamiva. What is happiness, what appears to be exciting and happy in the beginning, agre yat agre amrutopamam, very exciting, nectarian in the beginning, turns into poison the moment we enjoy it. And earlier also Krishna said, yehi samsparsha ja bhoga dukkha yonaya evate. Sense pleasures, the pleasures arising out of the contact of the senses and their objects, corresponding objects, dukkha yonaya evate, they are built in with misery. They are pregnant with misery. So adyantavanta kaunteya, these pleasures have a beginning and an end. And therefore an intelligent person, a wise person, doesn't relish, take delight in these kind of pleasures. So whenever we get an opportunity to enjoy sense pleasure, we indulge in it, and later we regret. When we are in the regretful mode, we take a resolve. We resolve that, oh, now any no more I am going to enjoy. But that determination doesn't last long. Whenever another opportunity comes, we again indulge, again regret. In this way, we go through these phases of regrets. So in one article that appeared in BTG, Chaitanya Charan Prabhu talks about he gives a nice analysis. He says, Krishna uses the word yoni, dukkha yoni. It's like a womb. So vishayendriya sanyoga, what is that? Yehi samsparsha jab hoga. So when the indriyas and their objects come together, a child is conceived. The name of the child is dukkha. And you cannot abort the child. In another case, you can abort the child. But this child you cannot abort. And the child is going to take birth very soon. And that name of the child is dukkha. So usually when there is, whenever the general tendency is when there are, we go by the feelings we get. If it feels good, then it must be good. And if it feels bad, it must be bad. So generally we take our feelings to be like signals, traffic signals. So if signal is green, indulge. The signal is red, abstain. So in this way, but feelings are highly unreliable. That is the problem with the feelings. What feels good now may not feel good at some other time. If the nature of sense pleasure is the red signal appears like green and the green signal appears like red. So what should alert us, should caution us, we think it is a sign of, it is giving me a green signal to enjoy. So such kind of indulgences, sense indulgences, make us forget about the ethical boundaries, the moral boundaries that we are expected to follow. We break that principle, we transgress those principles. And it, such kind of indulgences also make us insensitive to others' pain, to the environmental damage that may happen by such indulgences. And most importantly, most dangerously, such kind of indulgences alienate us, take us away from that emotional attachment we may develop towards Krishna. So therefore, we may think, oh, once in a while I am doing some little sense gratification. But depending on the nature of the sense gratification, the intensity and the duration of sense gratification, accordingly it will affect us. And therefore Prabhupada gave us that four regulative principles. At least avoid this gross sense gratification. Because they are the ones that cover our consciousness to the maximum degree. And as we advance on the spiritual path, make progress in the spiritual path, we need to become more and more aware of the different levels of sense gratification we may be indulging in. And accordingly, we have to be careful, whether it is mental, verbal, physical, whichever indulgences we may be doing, we have to be careful. In another example, he gives sense gratification. The nature of sense gratification is long in shadow, short in substance. So substance here means the pleasure that we get. The nature of the amount of pleasure that we get by indulgence, sense indulgence. So initially, when we get an opportunity for indulgence, then our mind starts imagining so much about it. Fantasize about the happiness that I am going to derive and the enjoyment I am going to get. It magnifies the whole picture, creating a romantic scene about the whole expectation. So therefore we indulge, we get into the trap. But unfortunately, the moment we indulge, it casts a shadow. The shadow is like the shadow of desperation, frustration, relationship breaking. These things come later. And the shadow is much, much longer than the initial length of the stick. So imagine this stick, it is casting a long shadow, depending on the nature of the light. So we don't see the shadow in the beginning. We see only the stick. And the stick appears like too big. And the moment we indulge, the length of the stick reduces. And we feel, oh, hardly I enjoyed anything. But the shadow cast is too long. And it takes days and days and months and years sometimes to get over the shadow. But as we overcome the shadow of frustration and desperation, before the shadow gets over, another stick appears. Another hope for enjoyment appears. And then we forget the experience of the miserable shadow. In this way we keep on, a conditioned living entity keeps on enjoying and goes through depleted frustrations. So therefore we need to strengthen our intelligence by Shastric knowledge, Shastra Chakshu, Jnana Chakshu, by studying scriptures, by analyzing the nature of sense pleasures. We understand how these pleasures are oftentimes futile. It doesn't even promise anything. It promises big things, but when we get into it, it's actually nothing, oftentimes. If not futile, it is insubstantial, not worth the effort. To get little pleasure by putting so much effort, is it worth it? That's what we need to understand. So material pleasure, no matter how promising it is not worth the effort. And spiritual pleasures, no matter how difficult it is, no matter how small it is worth the effort. So because it is eternal and everlasting. And sense pleasures oftentimes, even if it promises us, even if it delivers us the promised amount of happiness, it doesn't last long. It is temporary. So therefore Shastras repeatedly advise us through various examples, various stories, various characters, how by repeated indulgences in sense gratification, a living entity goes through a miserable existence. Every indulgence is planting the seed for a future birth in this material world. And therefore, gradually we have to overcome these anarthas of sense gratification and develop the pure desire of unconditional loving service to Krishna. We see the story of Kala Krishnadas, right? Associate of Lord Chaitanya, personal associate of Lord Chaitanya. But because he was captivated by those gypsies, Prabhupada says gypsies, of Bhattaharis. He was enamored by them and then he left the company of Lord Chaitanya. And then Mahaprabhu, out of his compassion, he delivered him. He released him from their clutches and got him back. So similarly, Mahaprabhu may not personally come to liberate us, free us, but the instructions are there, association of devotees are there, Shastric injunction is available to remind us, and Krishna within the heart as Paramatma also reminds us when we are indulging, when we are crossing the boundary, when we are making a mistake. The conscience within us prompts us and tells us, this may not be the right thing, please rethink about what you are doing. And if we are attentive to that call, then we will be careful. If we want to forget it, then Krishna allows us to forget it. Mattas smritir jnanam apohanam cha. Krishna helps us to forget the message that he's trying to deliver. And then when we indulge and then we learn the lesson the hard way. In the first canto also of Srimad Bhagavatam, like this verse is talking about varieties of illusion. In one verse that Narad Muni is telling Vyasadev, he says,
Tato nyatha kinchana yad vivakshata prithak drushastat kritarupa namabhi nakarhichit kvapicha dusthitamatir labheta vata hata nau rivaspadam.
Whatever you desire to describe that is separate in vision from the Lord simply reacts with different forms and names to agitate the mind, as the wind agitates a boat which has no resting place. It's a nice example. So wind that is having no resting place, not anchored properly. Sorry, a boat that is not anchored properly. When a wind is there, stroke of wind is there, the boat loses its balance. Similarly, when we have any conception of life, any ideology we may follow, if it is not anchored to the philosophy of Krishna consciousness, philosophy as given in the Shastra, such messages will simply agitate our mind. Because our foundation is on shaky grounds. It is not anchored to a proper, solid, stable anchor. Manovrathe nasati dhavato bahi. It is all on a tottering platform. So any calamity, any stroke, any wind can easily disrupt the stability of that person. In the purport, Prabhupada writes, he talks about demigod worship also. He says, Vyasadeva should not have compiled any Puranas other than the Bhagavad Purana, because a slight deviation from that may create havoc for self-realization. If a slight deviation can create such havoc, then what to speak of deliberate expansion of the ideas separate from the absolute personality of Godhead? The most defective part of worshipping demigods is that it creates a definite conception of pantheism, ending disastrously in many religious sects, detrimental to the progress of the principles of the Bhagavatam, which alone can give the accurate direction of self-realization. The example of the boat disturbed by the whirling wind is suitable. The diverted mind of the pantheist can never reach the perfection of self-realization due to the disturbed condition of the selection of object. So all these different conceptions, ideologies, theories, scientific, non-scientific fiction, different levels of reality we have, the absolute reality is there as presented in the Bhagavatam. Mundane realities have are relatively different depending on the influence of the modes. They have different gradations. So any mundane reality, if we take it as the support, then it will be unstable. It cannot give us real shelter. So therefore, it is like a disturbed boat. Therefore, Krishna says,
Parastasmat bhavonyo vyakto vyaktat sanatana yassa sarveshu bhuteshu nashyat sunavi nashyati.
There is another superior nature which is unmanifest, unseen, and has no beginning or no end. Yassa sarveshu. When this world is destroyed, that world remains undestroyed. Therefore, we need to focus on that thing, that world, and that reality. The more we tune ourselves to that reality, the more we are able to access that reality. In one book, Bhakti Tirth Maharaj talks about the levels of dreams. He talks about four types of dreams. Like a couple of days ago, we had this verse on dreams, Jagrati, Swapna, Sushupti. Sri Vishwambar Prabhu gave that class. So levels of dreams.
He says, the first dream, first type of dream, concerns with, occurs due to a result of physiological stimulation. So we are sleeping, and our senses are still active. So because the senses are in touch with the material world, it can create a type of dream. Like for example, we are sleeping, and if a train is passing by, the train's horn is there. So we may dream about the train, or like we are inside the train, something like that we may dream. So physiological sensations create dreams within our minds. Another type of dream is because so many images and impressions have been accumulated in our mind, even if we are asleep and there is no direct interaction of the senses with their objects, past images, years before or lifetime before, those images may come up suddenly and can create some dreams. And we may wonder, I didn't do any such thing. How come this kind of dreams are appearing in my mind? So some stimulation has happened about from our past memories, and it creates a kind of dream. Another type of dream is what kind of thoughts we think throughout the day. So we are deep asleep, but throughout the day we have been deeply thinking about something. So that can cause dreams. Those things, those people, those objects, those situations can come in our dreams. And another thing, the last type of dreams, interesting, he says, these kind of dreams help out to exhaust our karma. So lessons that are to be experienced in this lifetime may be carried out through dreams. So dreams can be used as a medium to play out the karma that one has accumulated. Situations that would normally have had to be lived through in the waking state can be quickly worked through in the dream state, thus saving time. So if our higher authorities, anyone, spiritual authorities, material nature, wants to teach us a certain lesson, then we may have to go through an experience in a waking state, some difficult situation, which may last for months or years. And then after that whole experience, we learn a lesson. Supposed to learn a lesson. And if we learn the lesson, but it has consumed so much time. In order to save time, sometimes we may go through a dream. And that dream can give the same lesson in a short period of time. So like Prabhupada talks about his dream of Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur. Saraswati Thakur coming in his dream and instructing. Two, three times he came. So, and Prabhupada learned the lesson immediately. Take sannyas. So similarly, a living entity can get such dreams from higher authorities, either spiritual authorities or demigods or Supreme Lord himself. Severe, intense dreams. And those dreams can give us that required lesson very fast. Otherwise, we may have to go through several lifetimes in order to learn that lesson. So that is also another kind of dream. And because the experience is through the dreams, the lessons penetrate deeper into the soul. And it registers there permanently. So he explains these kind of dreams. So anyway, coming back to the point in the purport is the disciples of Prabhupada saying how we need to get attracted to spiritual world and the spiritual realities. Then we start hankering towards that kind of lifestyle. In the third canto, this section comes where the Brahmaji is describing to the demigods how the Kumaras went to the spiritual world, and they were eager to take darshan of Lord Vishnu. And when they entered the spiritual world, what they saw there, that description is quite fascinating. He says, so these are the 15th chapter, description of the spiritual world. In the Vaikuntha planets, all the residents are similar in form to the Supreme Personality of Godhead. They all engage in devotional service to the Lord without desires for sense gratification. In the Vaikuntha planets is a Supreme Lord who is the original person and who can be understood through the Vedic literature. He is full of the uncontaminated mode of goodness with no place for passion or ignorance. He contributes religious progress for the devotees. In those planets, there are many forests which are very auspicious. In those forests, the trees are desire trees, kalpa vriksha. And in all seasons, they are filled with flowers and fruits because everything in the Vaikuntha planets is spiritual and personal. In the Vaikuntha planets, the inhabitants fly in their airplanes accompanied by their wives and consorts and eternally sing of the character and activities of the Lord, which are always devoid of all inauspicious qualities. While singing the glories of the Lord, they deride even the presence of blossoming Madhavi flowers, which are fragrant and laden with honey. When the king of bees hums in high pitch, singing the glories of the Lord, there is a temporary lull in the noise of the pigeon, the cuckoo, the crane, the chakravaka, the swan, the parrot, the partridge, and the peacock. All these birds remain silent. Such transcendental birds stop their own singing simply to hear the glories of the Lord. Although flowering plants like the mandara, kunda, kurabaka, utpala, champaka, punnaga, bakula, lily and parijata are full of transcendental fragrance, they are still conscious of the austerities performed by Tulsi. For Tulsi is given special preference by the Lord, who garlands himself with Tulsi leaves. The inhabitants of Vaikuntha travel in their airplanes made of lapis lazuli, emerald and gold. Although crowded by their consorts who have large hips and beautiful smiling faces, they cannot be stimulated to passion by their beautiful charms. So that drive is missing. The ladies in the Vaikuntha planets are as beautiful as the goddesses of fortune herself. Such transcendentally beautiful ladies, their hands playing with lotuses and their leg bangles tinkling, are sometimes seen sweeping the marble walls, which are bedecked at intervals with golden borders, in order to receive the grace of the Supreme Lord. The goddesses of fortune worship the Lord in their own gardens by offering tulsi leaves on the coral paved banks of transcendental reservoirs of water. While offering worship to the Lord, they can see on the water the reflection of their beautiful faces with raised noses, and it appears that they have become more beautiful because of the Lord's kissing their faces. Then he condemns materialistic life. It is very regrettable that unfortunate people do not discuss the description of the Vaikuntha planets, but engage in topics which are unworthy to hear and which bewilder one's intelligence. Those who give up the topics of Vaikuntha and take to the talk of the material world are thrown into the darkest region of ignorance. My dear demigods, Lord Brahma is telling, the human form of life is of such importance that we also desire to have such life. For in the human form, one can attain perfect religious truth and knowledge. If one in this human form of life does not understand the Supreme Lord and His abode, it is to be understood that he is very much affected by the influence of external nature. Persons whose bodily features change in ecstasy and who breathe heavily and perspire due to hearing the glories of the Lord are promoted to the kingdom of God. In this way, Brahmaji has described the nature of the spiritual world different. So, in the Brahma Samhita also we find Chintamani Prakara Sadma Sukalpa Vriksha Lakshavratesha Surabhi Rabhipalayantam. Every stone, everything there is Chintamani. And Kalpa Vriksha, every tree is a desire tree. Whatever we desire, ask for, the tree can fulfill our desires. In that Chaitanya Leela, we find the story of Mahaprabhu planting a mango seed and a whole tree, whole mango tree came out. And it had no seed, no skin. And the tree gave fruits throughout the year. And that was an interesting mango tree. So that place is still there where that tree was there. So all desires. So anyone who ate that one fruit felt completely satisfied. That's what Chaitanya Charitamrita describes. Similarly, in the spiritual world, every tree is a kalpa vriksha tree. We may desire anything, the tree can fulfill our desires. Lakshavratesha surabhi ravipalayantam. So there Krishna is taking care of cows. That's his main occupation in the spiritual world. Taking care of cows. Surabhi ravipalayantam. Lakshavratesha. Thousands and millions of cows. And Lakshmi Sahasra Shatasam Brahma Sevyamanam. All these goddesses of fortune are eagerly serving Krishna with submissive attitude. Govinda Madhi Purusham Tamaham Bhajami. So this is the nature of the spiritual world compared to the material world, which is affected by repeated birth, death, old age and disease. Occasionally we may find phases of time where everything appears to be nice, peaceful and prosperous. But somewhere within the back of the mind, this fear of death looms, and we cannot exactly enjoy completely. People may say externally that everything is cool and so nice, but internally they are convinced that this is not going to last long. And everything that they show, put off, the show they make is all empty and hollow, not exactly really able to enjoy, not able to experience real security and happiness. So therefore we need to be convinced about this temporary nature of the material world, dukkhalayam ashashvatam, and then we can perceive spiritual truths and realities. So I'll stop here. If anyone has any comment or question, I can add. Grantha Srimad Bhagavatam ki, Srila Prabhupada ki.